you, Melissa. Well, this is a day to remember, because years later, when Melissa comes up to read, and I've given her 15 or 20 verses by accident, it just seems to fall to her, and today I only gave her 4, so please remember that. We want to stand on solid ground. We want to have a firm foundation, and when we do, we behave differently. When our feet are firmly planted, when we know where we stand, we tend not to waffle. We don't place blame. We don't seek too much attention. We don't overly seek praise or permission. We don't procrastinate or pass judgment on others. We don't avoid necessary conflict. We don't give up when the going gets tough or when resources are limited. And we never, ever get too comfortable. We're able to push our limits and seek new options. Also, we're able to do what the Pixar movie company president Ed Catmull calls having intellectual humility. When new employees show up, they're a little overwhelmed. This is a company with a lot of success. And Ed takes them aside. He says, I want them to have a firm footing, and I don't want them fearing failure. So he tells them the litany of the company's failures, not the successes. He says, I don't want them not to have a firm footing. I don't want them to be less than confident in their abilities. He says, but I also don't want them to get smug. He says, when you feel you've gotten too much success, you stop innovating. You stop learning more. You feel that you've arrived. He says, I don't want them ever doing that. So the antidote for all of this, he says, is cultivating intellectual humility, an awareness that there's always something more to learn. Jesus is a big fan of this. Now we're going to look at all of Luke 6 today. Jesus has cultivated a vast following. He's picked 12 apostles from amongst that following. He's addressed the physical and spiritual ills of these people so they can now settle in and actually listen. It's hard to listen when you're suffering. And he says, now I'm going to feed you spiritually. And he turns the whole world upside down for them. What they believe to be good, he says, no, let's look at it the other way. And says, the way the world sees success, that's not how I see it. So he turns their world upside down, and now he's got their attention with those who are blessed and those who are not. He goes on and says, now I'm going to instruct you to love your enemies. Don't judge other people, but forgive them. And when you do this, you will see the world more clearly, and you will follow me well. He tells them that good fruit can only come from good trees. And he clarifies this more in case they thought he's gone off into an agricultural pursuit. He says, now listen, what I mean by that is that from out of a good person, there's a treasure of good things within their hearts. And they produce good out of those good things. Out of an abundance from that heart of a good treasure, they speak well also. See, for Jesus, behavior and character are never separated. They're all the same. Now we get to the clincher at the end of this, which you heard today. He's got them focused now, and he really gets their attention when he asks this question. Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do as I tell you? Today, we often feel that our footing is unsure. In this world, we see people who exhibit traits of those who feel their foundation is crumbling under them in the flood of chaotic events and are afraid that they will fall or sink or drop down a slippery slope. When they feel that way, they chase after the world's ways and praise and not Jesus'. They become withdrawn. They are loveless towards their enemies. They are extremely judgmental and reluctant to forgive. Abraham Lincoln proposed an antidote to that while the Civil War was still raging. In 1863, he was saying, this is what we need to do when this is over. And the North has won. He says, we need to bring those people in the South back into the Union and treat them with kindness, not vindictiveness. We need to love our enemies, is what he's saying. It was a powerful message, and he was planning for it well in advance. This is what Jesus is calling for. But instead, today, in a lot of places, there's awfully bitter fruit rolling off the trees. When we don't follow what Jesus wants us to do, when we don't stand on the firm foundation, well, I think that is summed up very well in a short scene from the movie The Empire Strikes Back, where Yoda has lifted Luke Skywalker's X-Wing out of the muck and placed it on dry land with the power of the Force. This tiny little creature has done this. Luke runs all around the craft, dripping weeds and muck, and he runs up to Yoda, his eyes wide, and he says, I don't believe it. Yoda sighs, looks him in the eye, points a finger at him and says, and that is why you fail. Yeah, Jesus asks us too, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do as I tell you? Jesus, talking to his people, says, I tell you where you get that firm foundation. It's a foundation that's built of it over time. He says, you do it by doing what I tell you to do. Love, don't judge. We don't need to try to correct the flaws in others. We need to address our own. So that's why you have a log in your own eye, a little speck in somebody else's. Deal with the log. So because you can't see clearly if you don't. Focus on your own behavior. Get that log out of your eye. See clearly. This might be the work of a lifetime. You may never get to anybody else. And seeing becomes central to Jesus. He says, I don't want you to follow those who don't have clarity, who don't see the world as it is, who don't follow my instructions, because they don't know enough. Follow my commands, or you will follow someone who leads you off the edge of a cliff or into the dead. My grandmother Hall always instructed us on leaving her house. She lived on a country lane, and there were deep ditches on either side, and she would always warn us, do not get that car in the ditch. Jesus is making the same admonition here. Don't get yourself in the ditch. We never did. Now, as disciples, he says, I want you to be like me. He says, although you can never be me, and that is a relief, actually. Thank goodness Jesus didn't say, be me. That's a tall order. But be like me. Learn what is right. Receive correction humbly from me, Jesus says. And then and only then will you be able to teach as I do. You'll become a community of informed teachers. You'll be able to move on and do good. And you'll be better by the doing of the thing. This is the gist of what he has to say. Do as I tell you. So, that's how we get the firm foundation. That's how we withstand the storms that come. And they always come. We do what Jesus tells us. We act on Jesus' word, and we have the firm foundation for our lives. We stand on solid ground. And we may build sturdy spiritual houses while we stand on that firm foundation, houses that will withstand the most furious and chaotic of storms. And Jesus says, now it gets dire if you avoid doing as I ask. He says, if you're giving Lord, Lord lip service, and you're listening but not acting, the consequences can be severe. You will have When the flood comes, you will have a house that is poor and feeble. It's an inactive thing. And Jesus said of such a house, immediately it fell, and great was the ruin of that house. And he makes it a little scarier. Jesus says, I warn you of the wrath of God against those who ignore my instructions, who refuse to do as I have taught them to do, because they will not stand, they will not have good character, they will not do good, they will not speak well, they will not be just, and God's wrath against them will be terrible. Their spiritual house will have no foundation upon which to stand, and it will collapse. Now you're going to have to excuse me here, as I enjoy a little snark here. I love it when modern thinking, from time to time, catches up with biblical wisdom from thousands of years ago. Recently, ethicists have pronounced that good character is shaped by good behavior. Well, Jesus was saying that to this big crowd thousands of years ago. It's good when these things come together. Goes right back to Jesus' good trees and good fruits, good hearts, and good treasure, and his admonition, do it now. Christian, good character is aware that Jesus is Lord and willing to act on that fact and on all of his instructions. That's where we find the good foundation today. And we know where our final allegiance lies when we stand on that foundation. It is with Jesus. That is our first allegiance. And we act accordingly. When we're starting a new venture, it's good to make sure that we build it on that firm foundation. That foundation of Jesus. And we act accordingly so that when the storm comes, that foundation, or that building, that new venture will withstand the storm. Now it takes courage to act as Jesus tells us to act, because it impacts every aspect of our lives. It impacts the way you spend your time and your money and your energy at work and at play. It impacts your friends and your family. That sounds pretty tough until you get to the other side of this, which is also how liberating it is to do what Jesus says. Because if you're courageous enough to do it, you're free from judging others. You are free from hatred. You're free from needing to boss others. You're free from pointing fault or placing blame or any of the other modern ills you can find in our society or see on the debate programs on cable news. As one writer states, to live as Jesus requires, as God desires, you'll need wisdom and innocence, courage and humility. And you'll also need to be eager. Because you have to be eager to try new things, to learn from doing. And it's been my experience, you start out with some simple idea and you start to do it, and then there's all sorts of little complexities that come up that you've got to learn in the process, and you end up learning a lot more than you thought you were going to. But you also have to be willing to stumble doing a new thing, to fall flat on your face, to laugh, get up, dust yourself off, and try again. And with this, you end up with a marvelous, lasting foundation that makes for better friendships, because selflessness beats selfishness every time. Better marriages, because deep loyalties and love beats out mere physical attraction. And the best church communities, because doing as Jesus calls us to do, doing that work beats being sedentary yes men and women who don't get anything done. So on Memorial Day, we remember the men and women who served and died for the freedom of all, that we might pursue Jesus' ways. We have worried, and we do worry from time to time, about our nation. And when it seems to be shaken to its very core by hatred and division and ills, both social and economic, but as an assurance, time and time again, every time this nation has been rocked, people standing on the firm foundation of Jesus. Jesus and willing to act have been reliable teachers and guides, voices in the wilderness, light in the darkness, and have helped guide the nation through its darkest moments. And they will do so, we will do so again, honoring the sacrifices of all the men and women who gave their lives that we might do so. All of our souls. This Memorial Day weekend, I'm going to turn to another president. A little balance here. This one is a retired president, a Baptist Sunday school teacher, a Habitat for Humanity worker who knows a little something about good foundations. It's Jimmy Carter, and he was asked how he felt about the decline in successive generations of a church attendance and affiliation. He had a very interesting thing to say. He said, "At any time in history, we've seen that the people who are less sure of themselves, less self-reliant, or less arrogant, they turn to religion. And now, in the evolving societies of the world, in Latin America, in Africa, and particularly in China, we see the most rapid growth in Christianity. On a global basis, religious competition over time between Islam and Christianity, or between the various forms of Christianity, has proved not unhealthy. It strengthens us to keep searching, to constantly have new ideas and implement them, and to add religious beliefs to our daily life." And that takes us right back to the concept of intellectual humility, and right back to Jesus' call to do. Jesus wants us all to stand on firm foundations. Jesus requires that we act on what Jesus has taught us to do. So, I ask you, as I often ask the children, can we do it? Will we do it? Let's pause for a moment and quiet. Amen.